A qualitative summary of student-created video projects, a strategy to encourage assignment completion and originality. Presenter, Dane C. Sorensen. Education Class 6777, Section 213, Using Data to Improve Student Learning. Professor Sarah Bryans-Bongey, College of St. Scholastica, Duluth, Minnesota, May 11, 2013. In Carl Sagan's seminal work, The Demon-Haunted World, he writes in 1996, "The problems in public education, in science and other subjects, run so deep that it is easy to despair and conclude they can never be fixed. Truer words were never spoken, and unfortunately not fully understood by the public and in many cases not by the educational establishment of this country. When I graduated from St. Scholastica and moved down south to teach English language arts, I thought I was well prepared for whatever challenges would face me. However, the reality was that my education in education was just beginning. When I prepare for going to work, I often wonder how the day will go. I think of the challenges and obstacles that need to be faced. Coming from a world where education was valued, to a school dominated by generational poverty and a student population that was over 94% African American, I found myself quickly frustrated and on many days filled with anger at the very students I was charged with educating. This was the beginning of a trek of personal and professional growth that continues today. Many of the ideas I will share in this short film came about in what I now realize was an informal and by the seat of my pants research project. The two classes on action research that I have taken in the last 8 months have allowed me to formalize and verify my ideas to improve education for my students. Across America are hundreds of high schools where the dominant student population is African American and students of poverty. Often they are one and the same, coming from both an African-American culture and from generational poverty. This is the case in the study of 12th grade ELA students from a rural Title I school. Students from either an African-American culture or from generational poverty face many pressures that do not make it conducive for high school educational achievement. As will be shown in this self-designed project's data, students from African-American culture and generational poverty often resort to shortcuts to meet their academic tasks, or they simply fail to complete their work. Brown, Wright, and Taylor note that academic cheating is considered characteristic of students with high extrinsic motivation and performance goal orientation, that is, with students who are more interested in the outward trappings of good grades rather than with real learning. In the 4 years I have taught in a Title I high school, I have seen evidence of academic dishonesty and high rates of academic shutdown where the students won't even bother to complete an academic task. The negative results of these actions on their grades are dramatic. The penalty for plagiarism or academic shutdown is a 0-point grade. To repair the damage caused by a zero grade for an average C student requires them to earn 6 average C's of the same weighted type of assignment assessment. If a student chooses to take an academic shortcut more than 3 times, it becomes almost impossible for them to recover their quarterly grade. A third and more common form of academic dishonesty is cheating. Cheating can take several forms. The most common is to cheat during a test. There are several ways academic dishonesty during tests can be accomplished. Students can look at someone else's test, both with and without the active help of the other individual. Students can pass notes with the answers. Students can actively give the answer to another student by whispering or using body language. A more recent advance in academic dishonesty is to text the answers or even photograph the test with a smartphone and then widely distribute it to other students, both within and without of that particular classroom. It is virtually impossible for one teacher to keep an eye on all students all the time, and it only takes a couple of seconds to photograph and send a test to whomever they please. In a survey on academic honesty given to the study's ELA students, one question asked about the methods that the students had used to help a friend during a test. In the chart, you can see the results, which show that whispering notes with answers and letting them see your answers on the test were the top three methods for offering help. Another method of academic dishonesty is to share answers on non-test assignments, such as study guides, worksheets, or homework. Again, many of the techniques mentioned for passing on the answers to test questions can be used with non-test assignments. The most common technique is where a student borrows a completed assignment and copies the answers verbatim. In watching students do this, I have noticed that the copyist does not even bother to look at the questions. Without the answers tied to anything concrete, there is little, if any, cognitive learning. My project's purpose. With the above issues of academic dishonesty and student shutdown by non-completion of an assignment, I have seen the urgent need to design curriculum that will lessen or eliminate these two academic harmful traits found in many of my students. While there could be countless paths to accomplishing this due to time and resources, I will limit this project to documenting past levels of academic dishonesty and student shutdown by non-completion in my classroom, and compare the level of academic dishonesty and student shutdown by non-completion in a technology video unit of my own design, where the use of technology will create a rich learning experience that has a high level of academic efficacy and little academic dishonesty. Much of my data will be self-generated from either previous or current classes through various quantitative and qualitative methodologies. Students for this study come from four classes of 12th grade English at a Title I high school. African American students make up 90% of the class, with the remainder being white students. Most students qualify for a free or reduced lunch. Currently, at the school that I teach at, attrition is a major problem. As seen in Table 2, the attrition rate of the 9th grade cohort when compared to 4 years later, the graduation rate, one can see that there is a considerable dropout rate. The three-year class average is 57%. In America, public schools have been a middle-class endeavor and operate from middle-class norms. Payne states that many of the norms or rules of middle class are hidden or not obvious to members of other economic classes. For example, sharing is an important rule of poverty. Payne points out that any extra money is either shared or spent immediately. Another rule of poverty is that one can never get ahead, so extra money should be used here and now. This also extends to food, clothing, and, as seen in the study's data for this school, sharing answers. To not share extra money or answers when you have them is rude, and if a poor person does not follow this precept, they will not be allowed to expect help when they need it. When I first came to my school, I was outraged at the level of cheating. My outrage was based on the rules of the middle class. As Payne so wisely points out, an understanding of the culture and values of poverty will lessen the anger and frustration that educators may periodically feel when dealing with these students and parents. Once I understood the rationale from the viewpoint of the rules of poverty, I stopped being incensed, but I also realized stopping answer sharing was not going to be easy. In poverty, the notion that you can't get ahead is based on a belief in fate. Choice is a middle-class notion, and because it is not an option for generational poverty, this leads to polarized thinking. everything is black and white. The educational implications are that many students of generational poverty quickly come to the conclusion of, I can't do this, when confronted with a task that requires prolonged effort. This is also a result of their not having or believing in long-term goals, a middle-class keystone. This explains why there is a large amount of student shutdown and non-completion of what they see as pointless and/or difficult educational tasks. In Tom Burrell's book, Brainwashed, The Myth of Black Inferiority, he has a chapter entitled, D's Will Do, where he begins with a quote by President Barack Obama. Obama, speaking to the NAACP, said, "We need a new mindset, a new set of attitudes, because one of the most durable and destructive legacies of discrimination is the way we have internalized a sense of limitation. How so many in our community have come to expect so little of ourselves." Burrell, in that chapter, goes on to discuss the reality of low African-American academic success. He points out that the achievement gap between the middle-class blacks and whites is even greater than between the low-income blacks and whites. In short, it is a cultural issue and not an economic one. Burrell lists several mores that hold African Americans back. The first in that African American parents, sensing their own inadequacies, stifle their children's urge to excel in education. Their children soon learn why even try attitudes. African American parents who want to have their children feel positive about themselves often become unreasonably protective and defensive about education. African-American students are often shunned if they dare to move ahead of the group and are accused of acting white, so black students stop trying. An exceptionally perceptive African-American student of mine discussed this group pullback as the crab in the bucket syndrome. If a crab tries to crawl out of the bucket, the other crabs grab onto him and pull him back down. I have often been asked by low-performing students if they will still earn a D for the quarter if they don't turn in an assignment. As a member of the middle class, my attitude in high school was that C's was as low as I could go, and even then, it was a grade not to be proud of, whereas many African-American students are happy to just get by with a D. These are the cultural and economic forces that teachers face and readily have to deal with in trying to educate impoverished African-American students. As part of a British poetry survey, I had my students complete study guides. On table 4, you can see the results of how many students had matching study guides that were turned in, and also the percentage of study guides not turned in by the class. When averaged out for all classes, 53% of the students had matching study guides, and 29% of the class did not turn in the study guides for a grade. Educational best practices would dictate that those students who are engaged in a lesson would benefit in higher grades, while those who partake in academic dishonesty by copying answers will do poor. Students who do not complete their classwork and don't turn in assignments generally have the poorest test grades. Table 5 shows that for the studies subject group with non-matching study guide answers, this did not turn out to be the case. Students who had matching study guides had the highest test scores as well as the highest overall grades in their class. My biased expectation was to see the unmatched study guide student group have the highest test results, but instead they had the second highest. The students that copied each other's answers were the group that had the highest test results and overall highest grade average for the year. Perhaps there's more than cheating going on here. Do they just copy one student's study guide, or do they share answers with each other? Do they copy the smartest student in their collective, or is it crowdsourced with bits and pieces coming together from more than one of the collective? How much help might come from students in other classes? What is the motivation for the sharing of answers? Is it the rules of poverty on sharing resources, or just the brightest students ensuring that they get the best grades at whatever the cost? In what ways do they extend the sharing to answers when it comes to the test? A second analysis of the ELA students from the Title I school on academic dishonesty and student shutdown by non-completion is about a British book review assignment which was assigned once a quarter. Students were taught in class what was expected in a book review and were given a sample and a rubric. Students had a minimum of 6 weeks to read and complete the book review. The due date for the assignment was displayed on the whiteboard and verbal reminders were given during the last week. During the first lesson given to the students about how to write a book review, it was demonstrated how quickly the teacher can find a plagiarized report by using Google. Table 6 shows statistics of 4 book review assignments given over 4 quarters. The table will show that the percentage of non-completion and plagiarism for each period, as well as an all-class average for each quarter of those 2 data sets. The 4 quarters average for non-completion is 36% and the rate of plagiarism is 5%. From a middle-class point of view, this is a horrible rate of academic unachievement. However, when you consider the rules of poverty, it is a prime example of D's will do, I can't do this, or as Obama stated, low self-expectations. In looking at the time period and the number of classes, it is evident that non-completion and plagiarism are long-term problems. Clearly, this assignment is not well designed for a school with such widespread academic dishonesty and non-completion. In a literature review on student-made video assignments, it was found that most were composed of the following steps: pre-production, production, post-production, and final public screening. In pre-production, students are taught about the background of This I Believe radio broadcast and then given instructions on how they are to create an updated technological version in the form of a video. A handout showing the students' topic choices, project elements, and standards was given to the students. During pre-production, students pick their topics and create their essay scripts with included teacher review and editing. When those steps are finished, student teams help each other video record the essay in the production stage. In post-production, each student edits his video down to a perfect take and includes additional graphics or music. For public screening, a class period is devoted to showing everyone's final video. Another aspect that I added to the public screening section is compiling all the class videos into one DVD and giving each student a copy to keep as a high school memory of their thoughts and beliefs. In Table 7 and 8, one can see the dramatic results of how the This I Believe technology video assignment did lower the rate of non-completion and eliminated plagiarism. The impact on the class grade average is significant when all 3 assignments are compared. To go from 41% of the class failing a book review assignment to only 16% failing the This I Believe video assignment is a 39% drop in failures. Removing assignments that are designed for failure by both African American students and generational poverty students would result in many more students passing this core subject. Students seem to be much more engaged and motivated to express their beliefs, knowing that it ultimately would be shared with their cohort. Action plan. Based on the preliminary results of this action research, it would be justified to do more follow-up work regarding the positive effects of video technology on limiting academic dishonesty and student shutdown by non-completion of schoolwork. Many of the same South Carolina ELA standards, as far as writing goes, are shared by both the British Book Review and the This I Believe assignment. Student non-completion of schoolwork affects many students' quarterly grades. The elimination of antiquated assignments that have built-in high failure rates for this student population would increase grades and learning. Also avoided are the cultural rules on sharing assets that are so contrary to middle-class expectations. This could be a very important factor in lowering the dropout rate because many more students would be able to enjoy education and feel better about their overall grades. My final advice to other teachers in a similar teaching situation is to never give up and to keep trying to find real solutions that you can bring to your classroom. We have chosen our profession with one thing in mind, and that is to teach and help our students. In spite of the inequities, bureaucracy, taboos, and wallpaper, further action research on this topic would help change schools from being dropout factories, eliminate the opportunities of academic dishonesty, and decrease student shutdown by the non-completion of assignments. It is easy to see that our work is not done. Thank you for your consideration and attention.